Yes. Can I start already or?
No, just a second. The channel is okay. So let me very briefly introduce you to say that we are very, very happy to have Akitaka Arriga, or Aki as people call him, here to talk about Face Anew. For a lot of people here that work in one of the four big experiments of the LHC, neutrinos are synonym of what we don't see. So it's great to hear of an HRC experiment where neutrinos is what you see. So I'm really looking forward to your talk, and you can start, Kita. And again, thank you very much for accepting to give this seminar.
Thank you. Thank you for inviting me to this interesting school. So I'm Aki from University of Bern in Switzerland, and also affiliated as the Chiba University in Japan. And I'm co-project leader of Face Anew in Face Anew collaboration. So today I will talk about neutrinos at the LHC, in particular Face Anew. And yes, this is the energy frontier of man-made neutrinos, and it is quite interesting project. So this project is supported by Haijing and Simons Foundation from US, and also Kakenhi in Japan, and also ERC from European funding. Okay. I think you already learned quite a lot about neutrino. Just flash standard model. The standard model of particle physics consists of six fermions, six quarks, and six leptons. And neutrinos are the most bottom part, is nu e and nu mu, nu tau. So in the standard model, the neutrinos are neutral and only coupled to the weak interaction, weak bosons, and left-handed, and therefore it's massless. This left-handedness and massless feature is connected because the left-handed neutrino could couple to the Higgs and have mass. But since neutrino doesn't have a right-handed neutrino, so it doesn't couple to Higgs and it's massless. And there are three flavors. So up to now, so this is a feature is neutrinos in the standard model. Three flavor, left-handed and massless. So, however, now we know there are neutrino oscillations. This means the neutrinos are not massless, but it has non-zero mass. And also, we know there is a CP violation. There are almost, we are sure there are CP violation in left-handed neutrino sector. And the non-zero mass feature is not in the standard model. Therefore, I put this yellow dashed line. This is within the standard model. Left is within the standard model. But the neutrino oscillation is out of this standard model region. On the other hand, we know our universe is matter dominant. Matter dominant, that's we don't know why. So one of the goal of neutrino experiment in current generation is to explain matter dominant universe. In order to explain matter dominant universe, there are several scenarios, and one of the most favored scenario is leptogenesis. That requires right-handed neutrino. It is a pair of the left-handed neutrino, but so that neutrino must be Majorana particle, And also this right-hand neutrino should be heavy, very heavy. And if CP violation on this right-handed neutrino exists, it may produce leptogenesis, and this leptogenesis create baryogenesis, and is connected to the matter dominant universe. And this story is favored among the physicists, and many people are working on that. So, however, there is a trick. So the CP violation in the left-handed neutrino, it's not exactly same, and it's not necessary to be the same with the heavy neutrinos. So there is a theoretical gap between in the connection between the CP violation in the light neutrino and the heavy neutrinos. So this part should be taken into account in the next generation experiments. Anyhow, this is one of the story to explain matter dominant universe. And I want to introduce another path. So in the standard model, it is said the lepton universality is kept. So lepton universality, I will explain in next slide. But the lepton universality is in the standard model. But recently, there is some result breaking lepton universality. And this is half out of standard model region. And one of the, if lepton universality is broken, this means there should be some new mediators. And for example, some of the mediator, one of the candidate is leptoquark, and this kind of new mediator could violate CP. And then this could lead to the matter dominant universe. So this kind of story could be another path to explain matter dominant universe. So, so I'm interested in this path and try to find some hint from high energy neutrino from the LHC. So the lepton flavor universality is that, as shown here, three lepton families equally coupled to the weak bosons. This lepton universality means nu e coupled with W boson with coupling constant of GE, and it's converted to the electron. So nu mu coupled with G mu, and nu tau coupled with G tau. And the universality means that all three coupling are unique and universal for all three generation leptons. And this has been tested intensively by many experiments. And one of the strong example is that the ratio of G tau and G mu could be, can be calculated in this way. So this is ratio of mass of nu mu and nu tau. And this is the ratio of lifetime of nu mu and nu tau. And this factor is a branching ratio from nu mu from tau to mu branching ratio. The ratio of coupling constant is calculated is 0.999. And this is almost identical to one. So that the nu tau, nu mu universality is kept almost the same. So this lepton flavor universality was consistent with all experimental results until recently. The last year's so-called flavor anomaly appeared. So this means the So this is from decay of B meson. So this case, this RD in X axis, RD star in Y axis, and RD means the ratio of branching ratio from B to tau and the B to mu, semi-leptonic decay. So the diagram is shown here, such that B quark decay into charm, and then the double boson is emitted, then it decay into mu and nu mu. Otherwise, decay into tau to nu tau. This kind of diagram can be calculated precisely. In particular, the ratio of these diagrams are calculated precisely because the difference between two diagrams is only lepton part, and hadron part is the same between these two. So within the standard model, this value can be calculated precisely, and its prediction is this cross, this with small error bar. However, the recent experiment found that this red region. The experimental result is a bit off from the theoretical prediction, and the difference is about 3 sigma. So this indicates that there might be possible contribution from new physics in heavy flavor particles. So this means the example for standard model BDK. So this is explained as decay mediated by W boson. So if there is new physics, this decay may be mediated by additional bosons like W prime, which is similar to weak boson, but breaks lepton flavor universality, or Higgs charge that's coupled to the mass of the lepton and therefore breaks lepton universality, or lepton quark, which may couple differently to the three flavors, three generations of quarks and leptons. So this kind of model could explain the flavor universality violation. This kind of scenario is now being tested by the collider experiments. So, but if we modify this diagram and put this neutrino to the left side, we can make this kind of diagram. This is the inverse process of the BDK. So tau neutrino interact with the quark, and it turn to the tau. And the other side, B quark is created. So this kind of process may be interesting to study because this is the complementary approach to study BDK anomaly, and this is completely new. This kind of process has never been observed, and tau neutrino is not really studied up to now. So it may be interesting to have a look on this kind of process. And in this way, we may answer some kind of question: why leptons are universal, and why we have three generations of leptons and quarks. In particular, leptons are universal, and we don't know why we really needed lepton to have this universe. And maybe something special for third generation leptons, tau neutrino and tau. Actually, we have some hints from OPERA experiment. So OPERA experiment have about 10 tau neutrino interactions in our sample. And then so among these 10 sample, we have one charm particle production event. This means the tau neutrino interact with quark and produce charm particle. And normally this is explained by the CKM matrix, so VCD, and then D quark can turn to the C quark. And the lepton side tau neutrino is converted to tau. So this is the standard of model process. However, expected signal in OPERA experiment was only 0.04, and the background is at the same level, but almost negligible. So expectation is negligible, but we found one event with surprise. So we didn't really search this kind of event, but by chance we found tau neutrino producing charm particle. So this could be also a hint of new physics like B anomaly, and so studying tau neutrino at the, with high statistics could be interesting. However, currently, the status of lepton universality testing in neutron scattering is poor. So this plot shows a cross-section compared among three neutrinos. And nu mu is precisely measured, but nu e has quite large uncertainty. Nu e has about 20% uncertainty. And tau neutrino has a very big uncertainty because there's not much measurement and we don't know how to produce new tau precisely. So that we should have more detailed study for tau neutrino. And to produce heavy quark like tau and beauty, we need high energy neutrino source, and we like above 100 GeV to access this kind of channel. We need high statistics and high energy beam experiment to study lepton universality in neutrino scattering and also special channel associated to heavy generation of leptons and quarks. So how we can realize this kind of experiment, we discussed and thought about using LHC as neutrino source. So LHC, as you may know, that LHC is the world's largest accelerator, and its circumference is 27 kilometers. And you can see the airport, Geneva Airport here, and it's really huge accelerator. And at this accelerator, 7 TeV and 7 TeV protons are colliding and making a lot of particles. So we start to discuss neutron experiment at LHC, but then, yeah, so we say, let's open new domain of research, neutrinos at the LHC. But people say, wait, Aki, there is no neutrino beam line and it's too expensive to build one. Forget about neutrino. So it's true, neutrino beam line is expensive, the example Dune, the LBNF beamline is order of $1 billion, and small neutrino beamline at SPS at Sun is cost more than $100 million. It's really expensive, and that is one of the bottleneck of neutrino experiment. But we found a tricky way to exploit neutrinos from LHC. So at the proton-proton collision, 14 TeV proton-proton collision, there are a lot of particles produced in the forward direction. And this is really intense beam available here, and those are mostly mesons are produced. And those mesons decay into neutrinos. And however, nobody really exploited this intense neutrino beam. And yeah, so far, none of them are detected. So that we started think to put the detector here. This phasor experiment, phasor experiment is originally proposed for new particle search created in this intense hadron beam, and this was proposed and approved in 2019, and phasor neutrino program called phasor new was also approved by Sun in December 2019. So how it works? So at the proton-proton collision, a lot of forward mesons are produced, and some of them decay into neutrino between the collision point to the LHC magnet. And then charged particles will be deflected away by the LHC magnets, and only neutral particle go straight. And neutral hadrons will die in the rock wall of the tunnel. Only neutrinos can go straight. And then by chance, there is a disused service tunnel here, and we propose to put neutrino detector here. This place is good because this is behind 100 meter of rock, so that most of hadron, all hadron stops before the phasor new detector. So neutrinos and a little bit of high energy muon reaches here. And in this way, we can exploit intense neutrino beam from LHC with a negligible cost for infrastructure. So normally it costs hundreds of millions of dollars, but we can put emergent detector here, the neutrino detector here, with less than a million of facility cost. What we can gain from this setup is amazing. This is past, current, future neutrino beamlines, representative beamlines. The highest in the past was 350 GB from Tevatron in Fermilab. And the current generation of oscillation experiments like T2K Dune is about 10 GB and 20 GB. This is the maximum energy from these beamlines. Then future experiment, proposed experiment ship at Sun is about 150 GB. The phasor new, we can reach up to 5 TeV, and this beamline includes new E, new mu, new tau, all three neutrino flavors. And the this energy range, starting from 350 GeV to up to 6 dB, there is no neutrino cross-section data available and no detailed study is available in this region. So it's unexplored energy range. So it's clearly the energy frontier of man-made neutrinos. And this is a comparison of all the representative neutrino beamlines and the LBNF comes here, this gray one, and the highest up to now new TEV and donuts from the Tevatron beamline, it's like this one. But phasor new can go several DeV, and clearly it's high energy frontier of man-made neutrinos. This shows the energy distribution of at the height phasor nu for different neutrino flavors. So nu mu is most studied, and there are a lot of data, accelerator data up to 300 GeV, and there is one cross-section measurement using cosmic rays by the ice cube. And the phasor nu can fill this gap between the accelerator and cosmic ray measurement and provide cross-section data here. For nu e and nu tau, so phasor nu measurement will be the highest energy ever. One of the special feature of this LHC beamline is very narrow. So the size of neutrino beam is about 10 centimeters for nu mu. And nu e and nu tau is relatively large because they come from Keon and Cham. So, but still the beam size is of the order of 10 centimeters. Tau neutrinos has a beam size of about 40 centimeters. So, using this TeV energy neutrinos, we will study production and propagation and interaction of neutrinos at completely new kinematical regime. So I will come back later, but for the production, so this 14 TeV proton-proton collision is equivalent to 100 peta electron volt interaction in fixed target. This is exactly interesting energy for cosmic ray experiment for the atmospheric neutrino production. So in particular, about prompt neutrino production, which is produced by CHAM decay. This is very interesting input for the neutrino telescopes like IceCube. And the forward meson production at 14 TeV is very interesting for QCD. And we can study CHAM and gluon pattern distribution function and can prove some of the hypothesis theories like intrinsic CHAM. And the propagation, so phasor nu beamline is very unique in energy and beamline that L over E is 10 to minus 3 meter pi maybe. So that we can study neutrino oscillation at delta M square of 1000 electron volt square. This is a very special baseline. For the interaction, we can study three flavor neutrino cross sections in an unexplored energy regime and study neutrino induced heavy quark production, which could be interesting in the story of flavor anomaly. And also we may encounter new physics effects in high energy neutrino interactions. Yeah, before going further, I also mentioned about phasor experiment. This is a forward search experiment at the LHC. And this is a search for new particles from dark sector particles. So up to now, the conventional LHC experiments like ATLAS and CMS searches particle emitted in the transverse direction, like this black line, black arrows. So this is because they are searching for heavy and strongly interacting particles. Their signal come to the transverse direction. And so far, there is no evidence of new particles detected. On the other hand, if this hypothesis of heavy, strongly interacting particle is not valid, this way of detector setup is not appropriate. So if new particles are light and weakly interacting, then those particles may be emitted in the forward direction in this red line, like same as the forward mesons. So if this is the case, we should put the detector in the forward region, and the beam size is expected to be of the order of 1 milliradian. So it must be really forward. The one of the hypothetical particle is dark photons that I will explain next page. And so the phaser is the experiment to search for this kind of light and weakly interacting particles, which was not searched by the conventional LHC experiment. The signal of dark photon in phaser apparatus is shown like this one. So dark photon is supposed to have mass, and they are very weakly interacting, and it penetrates 100 meter rock and enter to the phaser detector. And in the air or vacuum or air, it decay into fermion pair, and presumably it's E plus E minus pair, and they start to run in the detector and in the magnetic field, so that they start to separate. And these paths will be tracked, and then finally electron identification will be provided by the calorimeter. So this kind of signal we expect, and then try to find dark photon signal. This is the detector setup, and this shows the exclusion region in the parameter space. This is x-axis is the dark photon mass, and the y-axis is the coupling constant, mixing constant. And we expect to exclude this region in 3 years. The phaser collaboration consists of 64 collaborators and 20 institutes from 8 countries. And this is the part of member of the collaboration. And this is a picture from the first collaboration meeting in April 2019. Okay, then a bit more technical part of phaser detector, phaser new detector. So we are interested in heavy flavor particles, and for example, new tau. And tau neutrino is one of the most difficult particles to detect. Only 9 events in donuts experiment and 10 events in opera experiment were detected in direct method. Tau neutrino signal will look like this one. So tau neutrino comes and interacts in the detector. Then with charge current interaction, it creates tau lepton. And then it will decay into other particle and tau neutrino. So tau neutrino is short-lived. It's difficult to detect this path, this topology. The difficulty is that, what is the difficulty is that, first of all, it's neutrino. So we need a big target mass, tons of target mass to detect neutrinos. And from this tau decay, tau neutrino is always escaping. So this is a tricky part. And if no neutral particle is escaping, then we can reconstruct embodiment mass of tau. But tau neutrino is always escaping from tau decay. So that reconstruction of invariant mass is impossible. So what we need is to detect this decay topology of tau to identify this tau lepton. This is contradicting part, and tau is very short-lived. Flight length, the C tau is 87 micrometer. To detect this decay topology, we need a very high pressure detector, which has a resolution better than 10 micrometer. So this requirement of a big target mass and high pressure detector is always difficult, but we have a solution. And we can realize these two requirements of tons of detector and the micrometric resolution with emergent detector. The emergent detector is a 3D tracking device with 50 nanometer resolution. Emergent detector is a kind of photographic film, as shown here. This is one of the film used in OPERA experiment. The cross section of this film look like this one. There is two emergent layers. This emergent layer is a sensitive layer for the high energy particles, and there is two emergent layer on top of a plastic base. And inside this emergent layer, there are a lot of silver bromide crystals. The size of this crystal is 200 nanometer. And each of these crystals are the detection channel for high energy particles. And within one film like this size, we have 10 to 14 detection channel. And this is enormous number of detection channel, and this gives emergent detector high pressure. So as I said, this is photographic films. So after chemical processing, the trajectory of a particle can be visualized like this one. So this is a picture of a 10 GeV pion trajectory. As you can see, there is a sequence of dots. This seen under the microscope. This scale is 20 micrometer. So each dot size is like half micrometer. And this gives a very high precision. The residual from the fitted line can be evaluated, and this was shown, it's 50 nanometer. So this is definitely the best resolution among all the particle detectors.
Excuse me, Akita, one question.
Yes.
How far from a crystal, from a silver bromide crystal, has a particle to go in order to activate it? So it has to hit the particle, because the photon has to be absorbed, I know, but the charged particle how far from the from a single crystal it has to go, the charged particle, so that it activates that
So the particle should penetrate the crystal.
Okay.
Yeah, and in this photo, it looks sparse, but in real immersion film, the crystal is everywhere, and every 100 micron, the particle a particle will penetrate 200 crystals.
Okay.
Okay, then this is a microscopic view of microscopic view of immersion detector. It stops every time. So now I'm moving the focal plane from top to bottom, and you can see a vertex. This is the antiproton annihilation vertex I took in AGES experiment. And so as you can see, by moving the focal point, we can take three-dimensional data within an immersion layer. And I stress this is just 200 micron in the scale. And you can see this is very high precision. By taking tomographic data, we can reconstruct in 3D. This is just a three-dimensional display of the same vertex. So as you can see, immersion detector is a three-dimensional high-resolution detector and work as tracker. And you can see that there are very black track and also scene track. This shows the difference of DEDX, that by measuring number of grains, we can measure the DEDX and separate mid particle and heavy ionizing particles. To illustrate how precise this detector is, so as I said, this is a very small area, like 150 micron, 120 micron, and 50 micron thickness. And when I compare to the typical silicon detector like Atlas IBL sensor, and one pixel is already bigger than this view. So one pixel of IBL sensor is 250 micron, 50 micron, and 200 micron. Already within this immersion view, there are 10 to 8 channels existing in this volume. So this 10 to 8 channel is equivalent to the full channel of Atlas detector in LAN2. So this 10 to 18 channel only in this small view is quite enormous number of detection channels. And the immersion detector have of order of 10 to 14 channel per cubic centimeter. And this makes immersion detector attractive for many purposes, and in particular for the detection of short-lived particles. And when this immersion detector is made as a neutron detector, so when this immersion detector is coupled with the proper target material, we can make a strong neutron detector. So this is an event from OPERA, and in OPERA experiment, we have immersion film and lead plate, 1 millimeter lead plate is used. So, and it has a repeated structure of immersion film and lead plates. So this is not simulation, but data. And as you can see here, neutrino interact and a particle is created and it immediately decays. And it's from the this vertex point, maybe I should go to the next page. So tau neutrino comes here and the tau is created. And then it's decaying to another particle and two gamma rays. This is a typical signal of tau neutrino event. So having tau and tau decay into rho meson, and rho meson decay into pion and two gamma rays. So as you can see, this within this emergent detector, we can see the decay topology and shower reconstruction, so electron identification. And for example, there is one strongly scattering particle. This maybe. So there is one scattering particle. So this is a low energy proton. We identify as a low energy proton. So we can measure the multiple Coulomb scattering of a particle in the emergent detector with very high precision. So we can measure the momentum of each particle in emergent detector. Yeah, using this emergent-based detector, we do measurement in phase anew. This shows the LHC schedule. So we start discussion of phase anew in 2018, and we already took background measurement in 2018, and also did the pilot run at the same time. So I will show this pilot run result later. And the physics run will start from 2022, and we are preparing for the data taking. In 2018, it was in the run two of LHC operation. So I put a little bit history and it's a personal view. And what, so in 2018, in April, we had first discussion with Phaser project. It was just proposed. Yeah, just appeared in archive. And then already in June, we installed the emergent detector. Now, as you can see, it's very quick. And this is advantage of emergent detector. Emergent detector don't need any electronic connection, and we can do measurement very quickly. And then in July, we already found emergent detector can work, and we measured the background muon flux there. And already in September, we installed a pilot neutrino detector and took data in a real LHC beam. So meanwhile, we submitted a Phaser technical proposal, and then in March, Phaser is approved. So in 2019, we did analysis of a pilot run neutrino detector. We already detected first neutral interactions. And then we were confident that we can do emergent, you know, neutrino measurement at the LHC. So we submitted the Phaser neutrino program, Phaser new letter of intent. And then this was supported by the committee. We submitted the technical proposal, and then Phaser new was approved in December. Yeah. Where Phaser new will be shown here. This is a full LHC map, and the zoom of this SPS part is shown here. And the Phaser new will be placed on the right of Atlas and in so-called TI-12 tunnel. And this is a tunnel for the electron positron transfer line for the LEP, the old LEP accelerator. But for the LHC, this tunnel is not used so that we can put detectors here. So this is a phase apart and pilot run was fault here. So at the middle here is the ATLAS apparatus, and inside the ATLAS, the proton and proton will be colliding, and then the bunch of particles is created, will be created. And all the particles below, so 70 particles will be go straight after the magnet. But the all the particle below 70 eV will hit the wall of the LHC beam pipe. And then after 500 meter, these neutrinos or long-lived particle, dark photons, will come to the phaser detector and may interact or decay in the detector. One of the most crucial issue was the background through background particles at the LHC. So everybody knows hadron accelerator is very dirty, and hadron produce a lot of particle. In particular, the high energy particle is of course, and also the low energy neutron background. That we need to understand the background level at the site to perform neutrino and dark photon searches. So the simulation was performed with Fulca or BDSIM framework, and this shows the muon flux and neutrino flux here. So at the phaser part, this is 0, 0. Is the phaser position. And as you can see, there is a local minimum of muon flux at phaser part position. And this is thanks to the LHC magnet, which deflect the muons left and right, and that create a void of muon flux here. And on the other hand, neutrino flux has maximum at the phaser location. So this is because neutrinos is not affected by the LHC magnets. So we decided to do experiment at the on axis to have maximum neutrino flux and minimum muon flux. Yeah, at the phaser, there are a lot of muon, and these muon has quite high energy. So this is 1 TeV, and a lot of muon have higher energy than 1 TeV. So we did test with immersion detector at the proposed location TI-12 and TI-18. And this is actual immersion detector placed in the tunnel. And here you can see LHC beam line in very back. So this shows the angular distribution measured by the immersion detector. And this is X axis is the tangent theta X, and tangent theta Y is tangent theta Y. There is clear strong peak. This is corresponding to the particles from ATLAS interaction point. And so this is background muon and associated electromagnetic shower. And we also found secondary peak, which was not expected to have. But after some analysis, this was found that so this peak is corresponding to the ATLAS IP, but secondary peak come from the backward from the LHC beam lines. And from the this quadrupole magnet. So we found, yeah, this feature was found in both location, TI 18 and 12 locations, and we understood those let's say background particle from beamline. However, the height strength of this secondary peaks are very small, and we say this is not a problem. So more close look at the angular distribution. As I said, there is strong peak or corresponding to Atlas IP and secondary peaks from the beamline. So if we separate high energy component and low energy component, it was found that the main peak from Atlas IP is above 1 GeV. The peripheral part is mostly from the low energy component. That is understandable because the main peak is PEB energies, and that PEB muon can make a Bremsstrahlung and create a secondary electromagnetic shower that makes secondary component. So interestingly, if I close look at the main peak, this is zoom of main peak, and we can see two peaks already, so separated by 3 milliradian. Emergency detector is very high precision. We can, our angular resolution is 0.2 milliradian. And we see fine structure of muon angular peak already with our detector. So this peak is after 100 meter of rock. So that this means this muon is affected by multiple Coulomb scattering in 100 meter of rock, but still the angular width is 0.6 milliradian. This means this muons are very high energy, and it's expected to be higher than 700 GeV. And then we compared measured muon flux with simulation from Fulca, and our measurement agree with Fulca expectation. And we said our background estimation is good enough to apply real experiment. So this result helped approval of phaser and phaser new. And meanwhile, we did also pilot run in 2018. 13 kilogram emergen detector made of emergen film and lead plate or tungsten plate. So this setup was made, and then collected 12 inverse femtobands of data. And then this is reconstructed tracks in the detector. As you can see, there are a lot of tracks reconstructed. So this is just 2 by 2 square millimeter data. And already inside this volume, 10,000 tracks exist. And number of particles reconstructed per square centimeter is of the order of 10 to 5. But however, those particles are identified as muons and electrons because they don't make interaction vortex. So they should not be hadrons, but leptons. So these leptons will not bother our neutrino measurement because they don't make neutral vortices. So we performed a systematic search of neutrino vortices, and we collected this kind of vortices, which doesn't have a parent, charged parent, but have several particles emerging from single point. So this shows some of the neutrino interaction candidates. And as you can see, so from single point, there are a lot of particles created. So this is side view, and this is a beam view. The first event shows well balanced with respect to the in the transverse plane. This means the PT balance is very good, and likely this event may be charge current interaction. The other event looks the same from the side view, but it looks different from beam view. This may be neutral current interaction, and so that one neutrino is escaping. So we analyzed target mass corresponding to 11 kilograms, and then try to separate signal and background like by using BDT, Boost Decision Tree, one of the multivariate analysis. So the left side is neutrino-like, and right side is neutrino-like, and left side is background-like. And we observed 18 neutral vertex, and after fitting with signal and background, as you can see, it fit well with non-zero signals. So especially this two event is very strong, and this is well above the population of background. So we calculated the significance of excess of neutrinos, and it was calculated to be 2.7 sigma from null hypothesis. And this was this result demonstrates the detection of neutrinos from the LSC. And this is recently submitted to the journal, and it appears already on archive. Yeah, this is a very exciting result from our point of view. And this could be a historical milestone, because this is the first neutrino interaction candidate from the LSC, or more globally from the collider. Okay. So coming to the detector design for the RAN3 from 2022 to 2024, and this is already next year. So we have phase a new emergent tungsten neutrino target, and so followed by phaser spectrometer. And in between phaser new and the spectrometer, there is interface detector here that connect phaser new and spectrometer. So in the phaser new detector, we will identify new E, new mu, new tau by topology. And then new E will quickly develop electromagnetic shower, and muon will penetrate the detectors, and tau will express decay topology. So we'll have a 771 millimeter six tungsten interleaved by emergent films. And the size is, let's say 30 centimeter square, and the target mass is 1.1 ton. So this looks very small compared to other neutrino detector, but our detector, our beamline is very narrow. So we need a small detector, but dense and long detector. So with our detector, we already have 8 interaction lengths. This helps muon identification, and 220 radiation lengths. That is important for the electromagnetic shower development, and also multiple Coulomb scattering measurement. By having global reconstruction with the phasor spectrometer, we can measure the charge of muons so that we can separate muon neutrinos and anti-muon neutrinos. And this will provide large physics potential for example, for the different neutrino cross section for neutrinos and antineutrino, and also the charm hadron productions. And this phasor spectrometer will also help improving neutrino energy reconstruction. In the phasor new detector, this is a simulated event, 1 TeV neutrino event, and it will look like this one. Here, 1 TeV neutrino is interacting, and here it looks very busy. And this shows all charged particles, and there is one big bomb here, and this is due to the pi zeros created at neutrino interactions. And soon after, there is a secondary big activity. This is because of secondary interaction of hadrons, which create additional pi zero and that make electron magnetic showers. And this is correspond to the 100 tungsten plates and corresponding to 60 radiation lengths and 2 interaction lengths. So this kind of event will occur. And what we will reconstruct in emergent detector will be on the right, because we will put a relatively high energy threshold, like 0.3 GeV, so that low energy electromagnetic component will not be seen, but we see more clear event topology like this one. So all this data will be what we will reconstruct in emergent detector. The expected event rate in RAN 3 from this one, yes. Do you have a question? Okay, I go on. The neutrino event rate in 2022-24 is calculated like in this table. This shows nu e, nu mu, nu tau event rate by different hadron production generators. So our detector is 1 ton. It's very small, but we have 10,000 neutrino interactions. That's great. So majority is nu mu, and we have also nu thousands of nu e and some nu tau. So and the expectation really depends on the hadron production model. And that's interesting to test the hadron production model for the quad hadron production, and that's very important for cosmic ray physics and QCDs. So if we are lucky, we will have 100 tau neutrino events, otherwise we will have tens of tau neutrino events.
So Aki, we have a question that I also wanted to ask, but I didn't want to interrupt, but the question is, you sit there waiting for the motion to accumulate data. How long? What, you're not expecting there for 3 years, right?
No. So what we plan is to replace emergent films every 3 months. This means every technical stop of LHC, we replace emergent films.
And how long it takes to do that replacement?
Well, 1 day.
Ah, okay.
So we prepare full detector outside the tunnel. And then we just bring this phase a new part, we call phase a new box, and just replace them. We will make two set of detector, and then when we bring new one, we remove old one and put new one, then that's it.
Okay, that answers the question, thanks.
So over 3 years, we will replace 9 times.
Well, sorry, we have yet another question. How long it takes to analyze the data from the 3 months?
So the readout will take 3 months. So data taking will be 3 months, and the readout will be another 3 months. So the analysis analysis will follow 3 months later.
So you have some automatic system that reads the films?
Yes.
It's not that you need a lot of graduate students to do that, right?
No. I focused about more hardware part, but readout I didn't put in this slide, but we have a strong microscope which has the readout speed data throughput of 10 gigabyte per second, actually 40 gigabyte per second. So it's strong microscope reading immersion data. So now, old days, readout time was the bottleneck of immersion detector, but it's no more like that. The offline reconstruction of huge data like this one is actually the bottleneck, and that is a standard challenge for high energy physics.
Okay.
Okay, then, so this is the event rate. We have a lot of event in 3 flavors. And this shows the primary goal of this experiment is a cross-section measurement. So this shows the expected projected cross-section sensitivity of phase nu. And we can put a lot of points in nu e and nu mu, nu tau. So this short error bar means statistical uncertainty. And the big one is a kind of systematic uncertainty. So nu e and nu mu, we have a lot of statistics to put data in the cross-section plot. And nu tau is statistically limited, and we will have a single point like this one. And what we will do on top of cross-section measurement is heavy flavor associated channel that is of interest of flavor anomaly. What we will measure is charm production with different neutrino flavor, lepton flavor. So we will measure inclusive charge current cross-section and the charm production rate. In this way, we can remove the systematics of the hadron part, but lepton part will be different. The ratio of charm hadron production compared to different lepton flavor, new electron and muon, will be measured and compared to the theory. At LHC energy, we expect about 10% of charge current interaction will have charm associated. So we'll have a lot of statistics on this channel. We'll also search for beauty channel. This is expected to be very small, of the order of 10 to only 0.1 event in LAN3, because this is suppressed by the CKM matrix of VUB, and this is 10 to minus 5. This means we need 10 to 5 event to have one event. So, but still we want to search because standard model process is suppressed. That's good to find, to search for new physics channels. So if we have a BDK, B channel, then we will see like this kind of topology. So there will be a lepton, and then the B will decay into charm, and charm decay into K. This is a typical way. And if the if neutrino interact on charm quark, then the topology will be more interesting. There will be B double decay and charm decay. And if it's tau, another decay will be seen. And this kind of topology can only be seen in the immersion detector. So further interesting point is the QCD. So the forward hadron production is asymmetric gluon-gluon interactions. This means as is shown in this picture, the proton and proton is colliding, but the gluon, which has a large momentum from the proton, will interact with a gluon carrying small momentum from the other proton, will create forward beam like this. So one gluon with large X and one gluon from small with small X will create a forward meson. And this is asymmetric interaction. It is called asymmetric interaction. So this is interesting to test QCD process because the those carrying small x is below 10 to minus 5. This kind of small x region has never been tested, but Phase and you can test. So at the small x, there is a very interesting feature of gluon, maybe may appear. It is called color glass condensation. And this may be tested with neutrino data. So in the high x part, large x part, there might be interesting to test the intrinsic charm. That is one of the long lasting hypotheses in QCD, and Phase and you can approve or reject this theory. And yeah, this is about charm production by gluon-gluon collision. And that is very interesting, very important input for the astrophysical neutrino observation by the Ice Cube, because the charm production, atmospheric charm production, will produce prompt neutrinos. That is background for the astrophysical neutrino observation in Ice Cube or other neutrino detectors. So, Phase are new, but this prompt neutrino has never been quantitatively understood. So Phase and new measurement will help understanding prompt neutrinos and improve astrophysical neutrino observations. Yeah, then we are...
So, Aki, yes. I'm afraid we are running out of time.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay. How much we have?
Well, in fact...
5 minutes.
It's the other 5 minutes, yes. No more than that.
Okay. Then now we are preparing a detector, and this is the emergent gel produced with new method, and we confirmed the high sensitivity of emergent gel. And in Nagoya University, we produced the film production line like this one, and we produced emergent film by ourselves. At the LHC tunnel, we have installed, this is a picture of LHC tunnel, and this is LHC beamline, and this is phaser site, right next to the LHC beamline. And this is a picture of the phaser detector site. In 2018, there are a lot of pipes and cables, and those are removed in 2019. And the floor is excavated so that we can place detector exactly on beam axis. And then, so last year, this year, we continue to install phaser detector. And this is a picture of today. This is the magnet spectrometer part and calorimeter, and phaser new will come here. We also test the installation of phaser new box, and it's successfully done. We did the commissioning of phaser tracker, and we observed cosmic ray tracks at the LHC tunnel. It's 100 meter underground, and it is working. Just to say a few words for the future project. So after run three from 2022 to 2024, we will move to the high luminosity LHC era starting from 2027. So there we want to exploit this high luminosity LHC for the new particle searches and neutrino measurement. So LHC is currently the high energy frontier, and it will last for next 15 years. So we want to exploit it, and we are now proposing for the physics facility to do standard model physics and beyond standard model physics. There we want to put multiple single purpose detector like the phaser and phaser new and other detectors. So currently we are talking two options to extend existing tunnel or create completely new detector hole. And it seems creating a new detector hole is a more easy option, and we are talking about this. In using this forward physics facility, we can have a beam of 20 times beam and 20 times more target mass, so that we can do 200, 400 times bigger experiment with respect to the phaser new. So we'll have a rich physics program, in particular tau neutrino physics, and also flavor physics, QCD, and cosmic ray physics. Okay, now phaser new is the first neutrino experiment with a collider, and we will study neutrinos at the new kinematical regime. And then we measure three flavor neutrino and heavy quarks. So we start data taking already next year, and the detection of neutrino has already been demonstrated by the data from pilot run in 2018. And we are also talking about future project with two orders of magnitude higher statistics. And this is currently under discussion. Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you very much from our side. I mean, this was not only a very good talk, but such an exciting experiment that, I mean, we Are you hiring? There are a few here that we got interested in participating. Very nice experiment. And with a lot of profit, absolutely. So given that we are 10 minutes past the time, what I propose to do is that we don't do a question session because we don't have the time now. So the student can go and have a coffee before the last talk. You can ask the question on Slack, or you can stay here, but with the talk officially finished. If you want to ask questions, but yeah. It's not part of the mainstream. So we will have it 20 minutes, right? We have the new speaker. Okay.
Okay. Sorry, I misunderstood a bit of time.
Okay. No, that's okay. I mean, we could have assigned you two lectures without problem. I mean, we would have been, in retrospect, I should have insisted for two lectures rather than one, so that you have plenty. I saw that you had a lot of slides there and on the side to show. And okay. So basically, one question I had is, the reason you are running for 3 months, the limit is what? That you have so many tracks on the detector that you cannot reconstruct anymore, that it gets too messy.
Yeah, exactly. So we have a pile up of 10 to 8 events in a detector, so too much.
Okay, right. Yeah, and have people measured, for instance, this will be very high energy muon, so have people measured, I mean, this is completely out of the what you talk about, but for instance, the Bremsstrahlung of high energy muons has been measured to some detail, because you will be able to measure maybe a Bremsstrahlung construction and Bremsstrahlung yield in a range that probably no one has measured. Even that is new in here.
Yes, I think so. The TB Bremsstrahlung of TB muon, there are data from cosmic rays, but probably interesting to do with the beam data.
Right, you have the control, right. So is there anyone there that wants to ask a question that has, there were a lot of thank you very much, Aki. I don't know if you've seen in the chat. So there were just thanks, but I haven't translated them. And I was also very surprised that you compete with DIS measurements of HERA. So actually you extend HERA, it's amazing. I mean, you will go. And both that higher X4C and very low X where no one has measured. Yeah. So that's impressive. And then I had another question about the muons. Right. So those measurements will be mainly with muons, right? Which is where, right.
No, this is I didn't explain carefully, but this is about charm production.
Right.
So yes. Charm meson production. So by me.
Yes, no, I understand.
Yeah, okay. So by measuring new E, we can, half of new E is produced by charm. So if we measure new E carefully, we can study the Howard charm production. And that is the result of QCD of large X and small X.
And also these forward events will be very interesting, of course, because as you mentioned, but we worked in Auger in cosmic rays.
Yes,
one of the problems is that no one knows exactly the cross section in the forward region. And that's one of the big uncertainties.
The muon puzzle from OJ is very interesting, and it hit his point.
Okay, so something I didn't say to those that are still there, we have to double thank Aki, because for us it's going to be soon noon, but for him it's going to be midnight. So he's been kind enough to give a talk very late at night for him, but he's in Japan. So thank you very much, Aki, and I expect there will be more questions in Slack for you. And again, very, very many, many thanks.
Thank you for this occasion. And
okay.
Some of you join FASER in the future.
Okay. Perfect.
Okay.
Bye bye then.
And enjoy school.
Yeah, the last day today.
Yes. Stop.
Bye bye.
Bye.